You know, I've been doing this for 25 years, and things continue to change. When you're taking care of someone that's hurt on the field, you know, it's one of the things we never want to have our athletes to get hurt when they're on the field. But what we do want to have happen is if they are, we want to be prepared for it. And, you know, I don't care what you're doing. If you're not prepared and stuff, it can make a simple thing become chaotic. And if you are prepared, it can turn something that can be very serious and stuff, at least in something organized and make somebody the transition to getting them to the right care in the right place the way it should go. I kind of went over do's and don'ts. I have to apologize. My notes are kind of big here so I can read them. You know, 60% of the injuries are going to happen in practice. So many of you are coaches or things, you're probably going to have to deal with your injuries. Most of your injuries are going to happen in practice. I'm going to use football for an example. If we play on a Friday night, I will put 11 kids out there. The other team's going to put 11 kids out there. What that means is, that for my team, I may have 50 kids on my team. Only 11 of them are playing. I only have 11 of those kids have a chance of getting hurt each play. The rest of them are on the sideline. And those kids aren't going to play every down. So I'm even going to reduce the amount of time. Because maybe those kids are on offense. Maybe now we're going to play defense. So I'm going to have even less kids throughout that entire game. And that's time. When it's over with, it's done. There's not as many repetitions. An average football game is going to have about 60 plays. Offense and defense throw in there. Well, I put 60 plays in there. That means I'm going to have my kids only have 60 chances to get hurt. But if I'm practicing, now I have 11 of my kids here, 11 of my kids here. Now I have 22 kids on the field. And I also then, I'm not going to do 60 plays. I may be doing reps and drills and things, and I'm not going for just an hour worth of playing time. I'm doing 2 hours of practice. So the odds of somebody getting hurt are much greater in practice. So it is on game days, it's amazing. You get there and stuff, you have maybe a physician, you have an athletic trainer, you have, you know, the ambulance there. You know, everybody's ready, they got their kits, everything's all set. And that's great. But what about Tuesday afternoon at 3:30, 4 o'clock in the afternoon on the high school football field? What about, you know, Saturday? What about, you know, Thursday, you know, at 6 o'clock, we're having sophomore basketball practice in the gym. Are the doors unlocked to get to your first aid kits? Does somebody have a cell phone or the phone's locked up? Where's the defibrillator? Is it locked behind it? You're using the auxiliary gym. Is it locked in the other gym? Is the janitor locked the door for the night? Things we don't think about, okay? Most injuries can be managed with simple first aid. In the 25 years I've been doing this, I can probably count on one hand the amount of severe traumatic injuries that have really kind of, you know, got me at the end of it and said, wow, this was really bad. Most of them are things that just really simple can be taken care of. But just like else, if we don't take care of it and we're not prepared for it, something simple can become a problem. And they are going to happen. I don't care what level you're doing, what sport you're doing, kids are going to get hurt. Kids get hurt running around the backyard. So they're definitely going to get hurt playing sports. Prepare, one of the best things you can do. Obviously and stuff, we'd like to, if you ask me my dream and stuff, it would be to have every school, to have the state of Illinois say you can't have a high school athletic, high schools have to have a certified athletic trainer out there. That would be perfect. Because if you're coaching, the last thing you want to do is have to deal with this kid hurt on the field and then come over to the sideline, have to talk to him. But what about the game going on behind you, the practices, everything has to stop. And I can tell you most coaches here didn't sign up to, you know, to give first aid to kids and deal with all their injuries and have to call parents, talk to them in the middle of a game and stuff. That's not what they want to do. I don't want to do that, but that's part of my job and I don't mind doing it. But that's my job, is to take that burden off. Somebody gets hurt, coach, you need to get a sub in for him. I'll take him over the sideline. I'll worry about what they need to put what done with them. And then after I'm done looking at them, I'll come tell you they will be able to play, they won't be, so you know what's going on. And you go back to coaching. I'll take care of mom and dad talking to them. So that would be the ideal thing to do. Now, if it's not, if you don't have one available, you should at least have one coach on your staff, and hopefully most schools require it that's certified in first aid and CPR, bare minimum. I think that in the high schools and the schools they do require it, And, you know, I don't know if at the junior tackle level that's something that's required and stuff, you know, there. Most schools probably don't have that. And I would almost guarantee at the NYTF, the little foot, the kids' football, I guarantee that is not required there. And this is just, I found out the other day and stuff that there are cases that, some of you may not realize the AED laws that are out there, you have to have a defibrillator within 300 feet of the activity by law in the state of Illinois. 300 feet accessible. Well, if you're out in the practice football field and the AED's in your gym in the school, and I guarantee you, if a kid has a cardiac emergency and something happens, there's going to be an attorney out there, and he's going to take a tape measure. He's going to say, where did it happen at? He's going to put his foot down. He's going to take that tape measure. And if it goes 320 feet, guess what? You got a problem. Or is it locked? Is the door locked? Can I get in? It has to be accessible. All those sort of things. You know, the NYTF, I don't know if they got one up there at the concession stand. Is it available? What happens with the kids' practice? Do they? Things you have to think about. And parents, if you're there, ask those questions. They're questions they should be able to answer. If they can't stuff, I'm sorry, they shouldn't be running the program. There's a little soapbox there. Medical supplies. You don't need a huge, you know, mobile, you know, trauma center on the sidelines. What you need on the sidelines, ice and bags. Ice is probably be your best friend out there for most injuries. Tell the kids put ice on there. But do we think about getting it? If we have student managers, I got some decent student managers every once in a while. I get some that go a little brain dead. But it just takes time. Where's that? Oh, I got to go in and get it. Just each day, is the cooler filled up? Are there ice or their bags out there? Some towels. Towels are great for anything. Towels are great for that thing that's bleeding all over the place. Kid gets sick, wipe kids, sweaty kids down. Water, gloves. You know, if people don't think about that. But if you go ahead and you talk to anybody that works in the paramedic business, and let's see, you got a couple over there. You probably, the minute you come out to an incident, you put your gloves on, don't you? They're on. And it's not there because, ooh, I don't want to touch you. It's, I don't know who you are. You don't know who I am. You don't know where I've been. It's a precaution for everybody. Okay? You're playing a game and some kid gets it. Maybe that kid has hepatitis. I don't think anybody here wants to have that, you know, just from, you know, because I didn't take precautions, just simple things. Gauze, tape, Band-Aids, ACE wraps, things like that. Some things you might want to think about here. And I got this from this summer. I went and talked to the trainer from the Packers, Pepper Burrs. And he said, you need to pack a cell phone, an emergency cell phone in. And I said, well, why do you need to do that? And he says, what they do is they put a cell phone in a bag with $100, prepaid cell phone, a charger, and a list of all emergency contacts. He goes, because if I got to send somebody to the emergency room, from a game, and there's somebody's gonna go with them, how are they gonna get back to the field? They can take a cab, do things like that. What if their cell phone and stuff, they left it on the sideline, they left it sitting there, how are they gonna get a hold of contact somebody? People are trying to get a hold of them. Now, we're not doing anything that crazy and stuff, but this year what we're gonna do is, I got a small bag hidden down in there that's got $20 in it, and it's got a list of all the call numbers, it's got a list of all the coaches, the school's administrators, things like that, so the person knows that they can get a hold of somebody, because if I don't have it, I know what to do. Hand sanitizers, we talked about your defibrillator, having that out there. They're expensive, but there's so many grants out there, start filling them out. I fill out grants for defibrillators like they're candy anymore. Because if I get one and stuff, that's great, because if I get a couple extra ones and stuff, I'll throw one, you know, out in the concession stand, I'll throw one someplace else. I'll have a portable one that I'll throw right into the training trunk, and I don't have to worry about going in and taking the one off the school's wall on Friday night when we leave and remember to put it back. You know, you should have one of those out there. Everybody should know how to use it. The don'ts, okay? Don't move any athlete before you assess their condition. And this is really stressed. This is really important to go ahead and stress to your athletes. You know, you get a buddy out there and he's fell down like this. Oh, come on, get up and stuff. And they start grabbing him and rolling him over and the kid's unconscious. Was it a neck injury? Did he break an arm? Did he break a leg? You know, you pull him on something there. You know, don't move him unless until you know what's going on. Don't rush. Most injuries are not life-threatening. I'm not saying you take your time to walk out there and stop and have a conversation with somebody, but I'm saying you don't have to go ahead, you know, and call 911 because the kid's laying out there. Walk out, or kind of move quickly. Are you okay? What's going on? I'll give you a big, as you're walking out there, if they're moving around, you know, like this, you see them like this, they're probably, you know, it's not going to say it's not bad, but it's one of those things that just, you know, don't get all panicked, because if you're panicked, they'll be panicked, okay? Don't remove the helmet. This is my cardinal sin for somebody to do. And I've been places before, I know Coach McDonald's been there and seen people like this, some of the games. I've had physicians from other teams come out there and start popping off chin straps, you know, like kids are laying on the field. Don't remove the helmet, okay? Our policy at Newman is they don't get transported. They get transported with their equipment on, because I'm not an x-ray machine. I'm not going to try and clear a C-spine there on the field and stuff, unless the only reason that's coming off is if it's a cardiac thing and I got to get to something. That's it. What we do have is, and this is where you have to be, have somebody that's trained and it's nice to do it, is you, nobody gets transferred, from none of our athletes won't get transferred wearing a face mask. Their face mask comes off before they leave the field. And we take our time and we do it right. It's easy to learn how to do. It takes a $29.99 power screwdriver from Menards to get most face masks off. Now, if it doesn't, there's other options. There's a $400 face mask cutter, clip cutter. Okay? All right? That's an investment. You know, if you can, you know, Jude knows when I carry stuff, I have a bag that has a screwdriver, a backup battery, a manual screwdriver, and it's got two of those cutters in there in case one goes missing or a blade fails or something. But I'm just that old redundant thing to make sure everything's there. But you have to know your equipment. Say, don't handle wounds without gloves. Just put the gloves on, okay? It's no big deal, just throw them on. Don't assume. Don't assume, because this kid complains every single day in practice. He's got something wrong with him every single day. Because Murphy's Law is going to tell you, the time that you sit there and say, oh, it's just Timmy and he's just a problem. You know, like this, he's always hurt. I guarantee you, the day that you sit there and say, I assume he's just faking it, he's not. Don't ever assume, okay? Also, for parents, people like your coach leagues, don't do anything you're uncomfortable with. There are things I won't touch. If I'm unsure and stuff, I'm going to help the tables. I'm going to call the paramedics and get them to come in and take care of what needs to be done. I used the example last week. We had that alumni game practice a few weeks ago. We had Coach Proposti's son, Brett, ruptured his Achilles tendon completely, just practice. I sat there, went out. He called me at home. I drove out the field, went and looked at him. I got there, looked at it. You know, I'm like, you know, I know it's ruptured. I know what it is. He goes, well, can I go home and get it fixed? I said, Brett, I don't fix these. So what it is, I called Dr. Hanlon. Dr. Hanlon said he can go home or he can stay over here and I'll fix it tomorrow morning. His choice, doesn't make a difference. You know, it's not, you know. But I didn't know. I don't know everything. So if you don't know, ask. Don't do anything you're not comfortable with. And like I said, things like this, and you have all these people here, are great resources to use too if you don't know. The do's. Do be prepared. Go over things. Using for an example, middle of July, I went up to Fulton, Illinois. Went up there, fire department. Every year, I go up there and do an hour and a half. We do a practice on, we go over concussions. We go over what to do about how to board people, how to go ahead and take off equipment. We go out in the ambulance bay and we sit there and they put guys get on equipment. They practice putting them on. We go over what to do if somebody has a femur fracture and they're wearing football equipment. How do I get some of this stuff off? What do I do? What if somebody has sudden cardiac arrest? How do I do quick access for a defibrillator through there without having to take the time to remove all the equipment? You know, so you have to prepare. Coaches, what do you need to do? Your simple prepare may be as simple as having a first aid kit, making sure your cell phone's charged out there, and talk to your athletes and parents about what we're going to do if somebody gets hurt. That's it. Nothing real fancy. And taking, you know, going to the Y or someplace and taking a CPR first aid course. That's it. Do realize that injuries will happen. They're gonna. It's just part of life. Do talk to your staff and athletes about what to do if somebody's injured. Like I said, don't be grabbing them, moving them over. You know, if they're hurt, don't move. Just tell them to have somebody else come out there. Do call for help if you're unsure what to do. Okay? You know, calling 911 if you think a kid's bad enough up there, that's never going to be a mistake. Okay? because we all want to be on the air of caution and stuff to make sure. So if you don't know what to do, call. Okay? Get trained in CPR and first aid. Practice spine boarding with local EMS and things. You know, little things that I found, I never thought about this year until I went up there and somebody pointed out to me. If you're on the football field and it's muddy, it's raining, before Sterling put the turf on, most of you may realize what that field was like before, just a mud field, sand pit. You got a 260-pound kid out there that's, you know, that's unconscious, and you got to put him on the board, and it's been raining, it's wet. What's going to happen as soon as you lay him on that board? What's going to happen to that board? It's going to sink right down the ground. If you put him on a board that doesn't have runners underneath there, try getting your hands underneath there to lift that kid up at 260 pounds, or to get your straps to loop in. Little things you don't think about, you know, that can happen. One of the big things that you'll get a lot here, and you hear a lot here with concussions, concussions and cervical spine injuries have kind of been, you know, everybody has a little bit of niche and stuff. That's my little thing I kind of like to research or read anything that's on there. If you get somebody that has it, don't move them. Don't move their helmet. Keep their chin strap on. Don't touch them. If they're breathing, our rule is if we get out to you and you're unconscious, you're going to the hospital. You're being boarded and sent. That's I don't care if you wake up 2 seconds after I get there and you can recite the entire declaration, you're still going. Because you're out long enough, you're going. We have any bilateral neck pain, bilateral extremity pain, any pinpoint neck pain, any numbness and tingling in the arms and legs, you're going. It's not an option. You're going to the hospital. But you're going in your equipment. We're taking the helmet off. We're taking the face mask off, and you're going. The helmet and shoulder pads are staying on. Call 911 if you get somebody that's unconscious or neck injury. Once again, we don't assume. Educate your athletes to try not to move, roll, pull any athletes that's not moving. Dr. Torg and stuff was probably like the father of head and neck injuries, did studies, and he's got a bunch of videos, and it shows a kid that breaks his neck, and a guy grabbing his arm, his teammate trying to do it, and actually flops him over to the side. You know, you just don't do that. Tell your kids don't touch him. You stay away from him. Your staff should know how to assist the EMS with boarding an athlete. This is huge because in most ambulance crews that you're going to get come are going to have two people come out there. Well, if I'm there, I'm going to maybe control the head. I may have Dr. Welty there with me. If I'm at practice, it's me. And I have to call an ambulance, I'm going to get two people. Well, okay, who's going to help roll? I have the neck. These two bits of 250-pound linemen, are two people going to be able to roll and put the board underneath them? No, they're going to need help from somebody. The wrong time to be educating or having a discussion or telling people, hey, do this at this time, do this at this time, you should do this, you should do that, is during an emergency. If you practice it ahead of time, you know what to do. I'm fortunate enough that the coaches, you know, for ours, have come to the seminars I put on. We practice together. They all know what to do. They know how to help roll somebody. They know how to help position the board underneath. They know how to properly lift somebody. So we're not making education on what to do. You know, it's bad enough at practice, but if you do it on Friday night, you got a stand full of people watching you. You know, like the guy from the Packers said, he goes, it's even worse and stuff. He said, you got that stupid eye in the sky camera that's over there and stuff that's pointing right down at you, that's videotaping every single thing you do to him. Okay? So you want to make sure you get it right. If you do have somebody that's hurt, follow your school's injury reporting system. Notify the parents, school administration, whatever it needs to be done. Document it. Okay? This should be for any of the coaches out there. Go home, and once you get down, write notes down and say what you did. That's the litigious world we live in, so you're going to want to do things like that. Some things I want you to take away from this we did is you want to prepare. You want to get your medical kits, first aid, CPR certification. You want to practice. Just practice, what would you do? Educate your staff, your athletes, your parents, your coaches, anybody. Tell them, this is what we do if we get hurt. Your own sons and daughters, if you get hurt, tell them. Go tell somebody like this. If you see somebody else, one of the best ways we've detected concussions this past year was not by me seeing it or having some kid look loopy, is our kids on our team now know what that looks like. We've educated them, this is what they're not. And they've gone over and said, Coach, you need to get a hold of this kid and bring it. He's not right. you know, and that's how we found the majority of our concussions. So the kids now know through education what one looks like and say this isn't right and how important it is to get it taken care of. Know your limits. If you're not comfortable with a situation, call somebody else. Get your school, and then, you know, like I said, my plug here for it, get your school board to hire a certified athletic trainer. This is my big, you know, if a teaching position opens up at your local school, you know, ask them, say, hey, you know what stuff, I guarantee you that there are, in fact, I can tell you from the meeting I went to this summer, with about 10,000 other athletic trainers, the big push from the National Association is get athletic trainers certified in teaching certificates so they can become full-time teachers and athletic trainers in schools. It's just, it makes things a lot, it's a valuable investment. Somebody says, well, we can't afford the $10,000 to $15,000 to pay them on top of their teaching salary to go ahead and do this. Well, can you not afford that? You know, we don't have a problem paying a football coach, a basketball coach, or something there that goes with it. We don't, what is this worthwhile to do? So, the last thing I'll show you, and I told Dr. Frank, we talked last time, we're doing this with our concussions this year. This is what we're doing. I'm not saying this is what you want to do. This is called The Guardian. It's something that we started researching the past couple years. About 15,000 schools and colleges throughout the United States are starting to use these. These are, they're not anti-concussion. They go over the outside of the helmet. They snap on. They sit like this. There's about a 33% reduction in force when the helmet hits there. It weighs 7 ounces, so there's no extra weight on top of it. You can wear them during the games. We're not wearing them during the games. We're wearing them during practice, where we have a much more greater chance of something happening through there. The idea behind it is we've got a dozen of these. The dozen I got are going to go on. Every kid that had a concussion the past 2 years is going to wear these during practice. And then we have red ones we're buying that are going to go on top of kids that they'll talk about later with their return to play concussion. That if you've had a concussion, you're coming back to play, it'll be red. Signifies players lay off, don't hit him, you know, like this. But he can get back in the swing of doing things, be protected, and notify everybody else. Don't. Once he's been cleared to come back to play, I'll exchange his red one for a silver one to go back in once he's fully cleared to play. You know, so just kind of one of those simple things. They're $55 a piece. You can buy them by singles or something, but we talked about this last time, and this is something that we're going to make an investment in for the kids out there. So, does anybody have any questions at all?